Speaking of the problem of induction outlined by David Hume, the 20th century philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein said, "It is a hypothesis that the sun will rise tomorrow, and this means that we do not know whether it will rise." As a quick reminder, in the first part of this mini-series on an inquiry concerning human understanding, we discussed David Hume's empirical epistemology and the problem of induction. We concluded that certain knowledge could never be acquired by inductive reasoning, but rather only probable knowledge. In this lecture, we will explore the consequences of these conclusions. Specifically, we will address the mind-body division, miracles, and God. There is perhaps no greater mystery in all of nature than the connection between the mind and body. How is it possible for an immaterial substance to affect the physical world? Why does the will have influence over the arms and legs, but not over the heart and liver? The motion of our body follows upon the command of our will. Of this we are every moment conscious, but the means by which this is effected, the energy, by which the will performs so extraordinary an operation, of this we are so far from being immediately conscious that it must forever escape our most diligent inquiry. Though the connection between the mind and body is infinitely mysterious, Hume believes that our actions are predictable. However, he is quick to note that men often exhibit irregular and unexpected behavior. How do we account for this? Hume argues that humans are complicated machines with many secret and hidden mechanisms. If we knew every particular circumstance of a person's character and situation, then we would be able to correctly conclude how that person will behave. The conjunction between motives and voluntary actions is as regular and uniform as that between the cause and effect in any part of nature. Next, Hume shifts his focus to miracles. Many religions have miracle stories. In order for us to be justified in believing these claims, Hume argues that the falsehood of the claim would need to be more miraculous than the miracle it endeavors to establish. When anyone tells me that he saw a dead man restored to life, I immediately consider with myself whether it be more probable that this person should either deceive or be deceived, or that the fact which he relates should really have happened. I weigh the one miracle against the other, and according to the superiority which I discover, I pronounce my decision, and always reject the greater miracle. If the falsehood of his testimony would be more miraculous than the event which he relates, then, and not till then, can he pretend to command my belief or opinion. According to Hume, there have never been enough witnesses of sufficient integrity to establish a miracle as true. In principle, human testimony lacks sufficient reliability for a number of reasons. One reason is that people are inclined to accept incredible stories because of the sense of surprise and wonder that accompany the hearing of such tales. Another reason is that those who are religious zealots are prepared to give testimony that they know is false for the sake of promoting the holy cause. Finally, miracle stories often have their origins in ignorant and barbarian nations. When we peruse the first histories of all nations, we are apt to imagine ourselves transported into some new world, where the whole frame of nature is disjointed and every element performs its operations in a different manner from what it does at present. But in proportion as we advance nearer the enlightened ages, we soon learn that there is nothing mysterious or supernatural in the case, but that all proceeds from the usual propensity of mankind towards the marvelous. Hume believed that his conclusions about miracles had significant consequences for Christianity, which was the prevailing religion in the Western world during his lifetime. He criticizes the Christian apologists who attempt to defend Christianity through reasoned arguments. Instead, he encourages Christians to embrace their faith. Our most holy religion is founded on faith, not on reason. And it is a sure method of exposing it to put it to such a trial as it is by no means fitted to endure. The Christian religion not only was at first attended with miracles, but even at this day cannot be believed by any reasonable person without one. Mere reason is insufficient to convince us of its veracity, and whoever is moved by faith to assent to it is conscious of a continued miracle in his own person, which subverts all the principles of his understanding, and gives him a determination to believe what is most contrary to custom and experience.